WMJC.
Dan Haggerty here. Just a few days before September 11th, our discussion will focus on Islam. Brian Mitchell, Washington Bureau Chief for Investors Business Daily, has said, "The arbiter of official Islam will not tell us what Islam is, only what they want it to be. For the truth, we must turn to Dr. Srdja Trifkovic, a European historian of broad learning, sound political insight, and a keen philosophy." Srdja Trifkovic is a graduate of the University of Sussex in England, received his PhD at the University of Southampton, and pursued his postdoctoral research at the Hoover Institute at Stanford. Dr. Trifkovic worked as a broadcaster and producer of the BBC World Service in London with Voice of America in Washington, D.C., and covered Southeast Europe for U.S. News and World Report and The Washington Times. In addition to authoring several books, including The Sword and the Prophet, which we will be discussing today, Srdja Trifkovic has written scores of commentaries for, among others, the Philadelphia Inquirer and the Times of London. He has appeared as a commentator on world affairs on the BBC, World Service, CNN International, MSNBC, and other media outlets here and in Europe. Assisting us for the next hour, if we get through our technical difficulties here, will be Dr. Srdja Trifkovic. Dan?
Hey, Billy, how you doing?
I'm okay.
Hello, audience. At some point we expect to have Professor Trifkovic online with us to discuss his book, which, as Billy said, is The Sword of the Prophet.
I think we're still having some issues here with the hurricane.
I don't know what it is. A storm came through, and we've got some issues, as we say, but, you know, we're going to continue anyway. The Sword of the Prophet. This is a book that was written immediately after 9/11. And the title of it, the subtitle, was The Politically Incorrect Guide to Islam. And I'll tell you, Billy, I read the book. You've read it, too. It is definitely politically incorrect because it tells the unvarnished truth about Islam. You know, I talked to some people. Most people today, as far as religion goes, are either afraid to talk about it, or if they will, they're moral relativists. And you get something like, Christianity did the same thing. Christianity killed a lot of people. And I like to boil it down to say that, look, how many people did Jesus Christ kill? And the answer, most people say, after a while, is zero.
Even his detractors.
But the true answer is actually -1, because he offered himself up to be killed. So that puts him in the good category. And then the next comment is, how many people did the leader of Islam, Muhammad, kill? The agreed-upon number is about 10,000.
When you say kill, you mean personally kill?
I mean personally kill, with his hand and his sword. That's why the title of this book is The Sword of the Prophet. You know, one of the quotes that comes down through history about Islam is from Muhammad himself when he said, "It's me or the sword." And what that means is, confronted with the choice of submitting to Islam, you have two choices, either submit or die, and you die by the sword. Typically, the way Muhammad would kill infidels, non-believers, and Jews was by beheading. And as you well know, and here around our Philadelphia audience, it was a Philadelphia citizen who was beheaded on the internet by the followers of the religion of peace. So that's the background for this.
So Dan, this when book. You mentioned relativism, so would you say that many people just consider Islam as other religions and assume that there's the same parallels without really looking into the details and the history of Islam?
That's true. I mean, you can cherry-pick unfortunate incidents from any religion. or from any country or from any people. But if you really want to look at the truth, you have to look at the totality of the issues. Moral relativists. Well, officially in our country, and this is how religion is taught in the schools, religion is a quaint old intellectual crutch that was invented by people to withstand the rigors of life, death, pain, suffering. So to the modern mind, officially, religion is just a quaint old form of lunacy that people adhere to. Most of the time it's harmless, but we'd all be better off if we were gotten rid of. So to the average mind, the modern secular mind, all religions are just variations on the same form of insanity.
So kind of like the opiate of the masses.
As Marx said, exactly, the opiate of the masses. You could go on with a list of quotes right down to today. People like Richard Dawkins talking about how religion is just an illusion, a crutch again. And that's one of the problems that we face in dealing with Islam, is that people will not take Islam for what it is.
In a sense, not taking the claims of Islam and the texts of the Quran seriously.
Exactly. I mean, the one thing about Islam, it's not a religion of peace. I mean, you know, I supported President Bush. I've got a lot of problems with what he did. The one lie to me that President Bush said was when he stood up and said, Islam is a religion of peace. Now, I don't know if I could call that a lie, but it's certainly not the truth. And I suspect he should know that if he had any kind of decent education. And if he's looked at the news articles of the last 15, 20 years, they're filled with atrocities committed by the followers.
I believe that came after his comment about us being on a crusade.
Yeah.
Maybe that was to kind of make up for that misstep.
Yeah.
Although, in a sense, maybe it wasn't.
Yeah,
maybe
exactly.
Maybe he was just tipping his hand of what he really thought.
Yeah, he used the word crusade, which, as everyone knows, is probably an offensive concept to any Muslim. But, you know, that's a good thing to bring up, Billy. The crusades are taught now in the academy and in schools in the United States and in Europe as a rapacious act of plunder.
You want to define rapacious for those of us who might not be
a bad thing, kind of like rape. But it was an act of plunder, conquest, and looting committed by the European people upon the poor, innocent people of Islam. Well, that's just not true. I mean, there were some instances of looting, rape, and murder, and pillaging. And you know what? That's what armies do, and it's a terrible thing. But the Crusades were not a military adventure thought up to rob the Holy Land. The Crusades occurred because for well over 100 years, the Muslims who controlled...
Well, what years, Dan?
For the years leading up to the year 1000, basically, the late 900s. Ever since the crucifixion and death of Christ, Jerusalem has been the Holy Land, not only for Jews, but for Christians, up until the time that Islam came on the scene, which is about in the early part of the years of the 600s, be the 7th century. Christian pilgrims generally were unmolested traveling to Jerusalem, even after Islam took over Jerusalem. But in the 700s, 800s, and 900s, Christian missionaries were robbed, beaten, tortured, kidnapped, and it finally became intolerable. And the nobles in the West got together and said, this has to be stopped.
What type of numbers are we talking? Do you have any sense of the numbers here historically?
No, there's not much that I can tell you about how many Christians were persecuted or not. But, I mean, they were coming back from pilgrimages with many of their numbers dead or missing, with tales of this ill treatment at the hands of Islamists, Muslims, followers of the religion of peace. One of the great myths of our history that's being imposed upon us is that these nobles did this for personal gain, for plunder. But that's untrue. If you read the book God's Battalions by Rodney Stark, it's a very interesting book. He goes into the background of the Crusades and the nobles who actually had to sell what they owned to raise the private army to join the crusade. Many of them went bankrupt before they even left their homelands. There's letters in the book, there's wills, there's codicils and other documents where the nobles are saying, you know, I'm giving my castle to the king, to my brother-in-law, to my sister. I'm selling everything I own, my thousands of head of cattle, to equip my...
So your point is they were very motivated to partake in this.
Well, they were motivated for essentially religious reasons. They weren't. The primary motivation was not to plunder the Holy Land. Some of that did occur, but that wasn't the motivation for it. And that's what's taught in our schools, in our culture today, and that's a terrible mistake.
In the government schools?
It's exactly in our government-run schools. But Billy, I'll tell you what, the myth is so pervasive and persuasive that I'll wager that even in ostensibly religious schools this is taught. And in fact, I know it is. In Catholic colleges, Georgetown, Notre Dame. In fact, in Georgetown, I'm trying to remember who the speaker was that came to Georgetown and asked that the crucifixes and crosses be covered up. Yes. So as not to insult the speaker. Obama asked this to be done. Well, a lot of people believe Obama himself is a Muslim. We can get into that later. But basically, the point of Professor Trifkovic's book is that the West is completely deluded in its dealings with Islam. The West believes that accommodation can be made with Islam. And as Professor Trifkovic points out through many historical chapters in his book, it cannot be done. There is no accommodation because the goal of Islam is jihad.
Now what you're saying is it's intrinsic in the text of the Quran as opposed to something that's just been added as a matter of amendments or just the way things have developed over the years. This is stuff that's traced to the text.
Exactly. There's an interesting thing about the Quran. There are many passages and quotes that seem to contradict each other in the Quran. The most recent quotes abrogate the earlier quotes.
That's actually in the Quran, correct?
Yeah, that's intentional.
As a way to interpret the Quran.
Exactly. In fact, in earlier verses in the Quran, and you'll always hear these quoted by Islamic apologists, the earlier quotations in the Quran say, oh, treat the people of the book, meaning Christians and Jews, treat the people of the book with respect for, you know, we share our belief in Abraham as the founder of our religion, that kind of thing. We believe in one God. But later on, the tone of the Quran changes radically, and you get into the quotations and verses that call for chopping the heads off of the unbeliever, pouring boiling oil down their throats. And the directives to the followers of Islam is to believe the later verses of the Quran because they abrogate, they supersede the earlier verses. So if you look at the later verses of the Quran, it's just a continuous flow of violence against infidels and non-believers.
Well, one point I think that's worth making is that there's really nothing that I know of that would be consistent with textual criticism, that is delving into the authenticity, the accuracy of the text that we have that's called the Quran, meaning that there really isn't much study going on regarding what was written, when it was written, and how accurate it is. So pretty much the Quran is taken at face value. So it almost doesn't matter how the Quran came about because the text is used as basically the guidebook. You could say it's analogous to the Bible, but in some ways it's not because the Bible is, we try to substantiate what's in the Bible, where it came from, and things to that effect, whereas the Quran is understood as virtually dictated by God, like you could say analogous to the Ten Commandments. Is that correct?
Exactly. It's a revelation. It's a compilation of revelations given privately to Muhammad. So when he came out and said, this is what needs to be done, and it contradicted earlier behavior or seemed odd to his followers, he said, well, this is a revelation from God. I just
right, go argue with God.
Right. And a very interesting example of this was when he decided that he wanted the sexual pleasures of his nephew's wife, who was underage at the time.
Right.
He just said, look, I just got a revelation from God that I can take your wife. Do you have any problems with that? And wanting to live and not die by the sword, this young man said, yeah, go ahead, take my wife, which is what he did. So, I mean, that's pretty gruesome. So, yeah, it's a religion of revelation, and it has nowhere near the historical provenance that the Bible has. As you know, the Dead Sea Scrolls and the most recent metallic documents that were found in Syria this year, in fact, are providing more proof.
So for our purposes, the bottom line is that it doesn't matter whether Muhammad wrote this, whether somebody else wrote it, whether God revealed it. It really doesn't matter for our purposes. The bottom line is that a good Muslim takes the Quran for what it says and incorporates the doctrine of
exactly
the later verses superseding the prior verses, and this is what we're left with.
Yeah, exactly. It's that is the issue. That is the issue. So there you have the Quran, which is the founding document of Islam, and the part of the Quran that we're told is the important part is a relatively peaceful document. The part of the Quran that Islamists believe is the part at the end that calls for the killing of Christians now and Jews now that and infidels. Now that doesn't mean that every Muslim is a killer or a terrorist, but what it does mean is that the document that they are commanded to adhere to calls out for them to become a jihadist, essentially a terrorist.
So it's inseparable from being a good Muslim?
Exactly. And the problem with that is being a good Muslim is inherently incompatible with being an American citizen.
Well, what do you mean? I mean, that's a pretty significant statement. In what ways do you mean that?
Why don't we
first go through very briefly what you would say or what we would think it takes to be a, quote, good American citizen? And then contrast it with what we're saying Islam would teach.
Well, you know, it's not even a matter of being a good American citizen. It's a matter of what's in our founding documents. Primarily that all men are created equal and should be treated equal. In Islam, there are two classes of people. There are Muslims and infidels. And throughout any society that is ruled under Sharia law, the foundation of Islamic justice or governance, throughout any society that is ruled by Sharia law, infidels are treated as second-class citizens. And there's a whole list of prescriptions as to how citizens are to be treated. They're to be taxed more. Their testimony is given half the weight in a trial. If a Muslim says that, in certain countries, if a Muslim says that an infidel insulted Islam, that infidel can be put to death, and that's it. There's no defense. That's all you need is the word.
Are these things really carried out, or are these just hypothetical?
No, they are carried out. They are carried out. Not in most Muslim societies, because most of the larger Muslim societies, and I'd say Turkey and Indonesia are good examples, they have a relatively, Indonesia has a relatively multicultural society. Turkey is a society that has tried to adhere to Western standards, tried to modernize. So you wouldn't see that kind of thing happening there. But in strict,
I mean, being a member of NATO, you would think would be kind of inconsistent. Turkey, I'm referring
right,
to,
right.
would be kind of inconsistent with, I mean, the idea of going into battle with the infidel seems strange, especially when the infidel might choose to battle Muslim countries.
Exactly. Well, let me talk about Turkey for a second. As a matter of expediency, we encouraged Turkey to join NATO as a bulwark against communism because of their strategic location. And we had military bases there in Incirlik.
You actually do read these books.
I actually do. I do. I like this stuff. And I'll tell you what, Billy, if more people read it, there'd be a lot of people losing sleep at night because it is very scary.
Not that we need any help with that.
Yeah, it's very scary what we're in for. But let me talk about Turkey for a second. Just to tell you that later on I want to get into the special case of Turkey and the city of Smyrna. We'll talk about that a little later in the show.
Okay, so where does Islam fit? So let's get back to what we're discussing about the fitting in or being a quote good American citizen.
Well, I don't.
You started talking about the Declaration of Independence, and
you can't be a good American citizen and adhere totally to Islam at the same time. It's incompatible.
In what sense?
Well, as I said,
in terms of loyalty, in terms of what?
Well, certainly.
I mean, let's face it. I mean, we've heard these complaints for years, whether John F. Kennedy being a Roman Catholic or a candidate being Jewish, and maybe their allegiance to Israel before their allegiance to the United States. Is that what you're talking about, or?
No, it's a different sort of thing because, from my perspective, I would say that someone like Kennedy, who was a Christian.
Christian in the sense of
he was a Christian.
Uh-huh.
I mean, a Roman Catholic is a Christian. Mm-hmm. America is a Christian country. No matter what people say, 80 to 85% of Americans list Christianity as their allegiance, regardless of how well or not they adhere to mm-hmm. it or practice it. But more fundamental than that is that the foundational principles of the United States are Christian principles.
Right, irrespective of whether the people who wrote the documents actually believe strictly in what many people would say is fundamental Christian biblical beliefs or whatever.
Well, fundamentalism is uh-huh. an 18th century development. It was uh-huh. the fundamentals that you had to believe in, mm-hmm. and that was a specified part of Protestantism. But the signers of the Declaration and the founders of our country were all religious people. They believed in God one way or another.
But I'm saying irrespective of their personal beliefs, they still had certain theology that they incorporated into their politics and their philosophy.
Exactly. It was right. The politics of Christianity, which says that the soul is inviolable, the soul is the property of a person, and the extension of the soul, as St. Augustine pointed out, is your property.
Augustine, you pronounced that correctly.
Yeah, not Augustine. The soul is inviolable. The personhood, the sanctity of the person is inviolable. Now, of course, that's trashed in this country with abortion. 50 million dead Americans since abortion was legalized. So no matter how they spin it, that's the taking.
Okay, let's take this back.
Taking of life. But to go back to a second, the foundational American documents were that our liberty and the pursuit of happiness are fundamental rights endowed by our Creator. Okay, now, that doesn't sound too different from Islam, does it? What would you say, Billy?
It sounds similar. It sounds similar enough.
Except that in the founding documents of the United States, all citizens of this country were to be treated equally. Equal before the law, with equal rights that could not be abrogated by the government. And that's not a part of Islam.
Let's switch this up a little, Dan. Speak about some of the goals of Islam. Maybe that'll elucidate how there's some incompatibility here.
Well, the goal of Islam is for the entire world to become believers.
I mean, that's kind of the goal of Christianity, too.
The goal of Christianity is for everyone in the world to be able to save their soul and enter the kingdom of heaven. There's a subtle difference there. Christianity does not require the subjugation or oppression of people in order to achieve that goal. Islam does.
So you said similar goals, but different means?
Vastly different means. Yeah, I mean, you have a background in biblical studies, Billy. I mean, you know the difference between the two books and among all religious systems. There's just a big difference with Islam. And we don't talk about it. Now, I want to read a quote here from Professor Trifkovic's book. It's pretty good. It is remarkable that in this age of rampant victimology, the persecution of Christians by Muslims has become a taboo subject in the Western Academy. A complex web of myths, outright lies, and deliberately imposed silence dominates it. 13 centuries of religious discrimination, causing suffering and death of countless millions, have been covered by the myth of Islamic tolerance. that is as hurtful to the few descendants of the victims as it is useless as a means of appeasing latter-day jihadists. The silence and lies perpetrated by the Western Academy and media class facilitates the perpetuation of religious discrimination and persecution even today. So that's the difference. I mean, there's a couple of things he's saying here that we're cooperating with obscuring history and hiding the truth of the religion of Islam, number one, and it permits the persecution and religious discrimination of that religion wherever it exists, and that's incompatible with American citizenship. Now, in places like Michigan, where they're installing Sharia law, they don't understand that that's the thin end of the wedge that will divide this society. I mean, it's pretty brutal. You know, you hear every once in a while about these honor killings. The Fort Hood massacre, you know, the media and the Obama administration bent over backwards trying to say he was not an Islamic terrorist. Well, don't be stupid. The man was screaming Allahu Akbar when he was shooting people. Of course he's a jihadist.
Right, and for quite some time he was speaking of his problem with being in the military and that we were fighting in
exactly.
Muslim lands.
Do you remember the D.C. sniper?
Right.
You remember, I'm trying to think who he was, Phil Donahue,
Right, go ahead.
Phil Donahue says on his show, I remember this, he says, I know in my heart it's a white man. I know in my heart. You know, that was one of his last shows, thank God. Well, he wasn't a white man.
So I guess the guys they arrested the wrong person, though.
Yeah, exactly. He was a black man. Not only that, his name was Muhammad. He was killing infidels. As much as they try to cover it up, that was part of jihad. The Fort Hood killings are part of jihad. The attack on the World Trade Center is a part of jihad. If we had another hour and a half, I could list all the attacks that have occurred in this century. And we'll get into one of them later. We'll get into one of the most brutal massacres in modern times later on in the show to kind of close things out. But I mean, that's essentially what it is. It's uncompromising in its...
So what would you say of followers, well, I guess that's kind of begging the question, what would you say of Muslims who would say that they could be American citizens, not have a problem with loyalty to the country, and subordinate their religious views to the Constitution, essentially?
Well, that sounds very nice, and some of them actually believe that. But when the rubber hits the road, when it gets down to it, they have to make a choice between being an adherent of Islam or not.
So, would you say that the strict, the good Muslims are the ones that are concerned with? I believe I read somewhere in the book. Maybe you could find the place where Trifkovic distinguishes between Muslims who don't follow the religion and Muslims who do follow the religion. I think he put it in the context of only one way to get out of the dilemma of having whether it's the United States or other countries that we could talk about in a while, other countries in Europe that are being dominated more and more by Islam.
Well, I'm not sure. What do you mean by that?
He was just explaining. It'd be great if we could have access to him. He's supposed to call in, but... anyway, there was a part where he was saying that if the demographics go in the direction that they're going,
I see
that that the only way to stem the domination of Islam in a given society is basically to have essentially secular Muslims who aren't good Muslims. The same with the analogy he drew, I think, was with a country that had a very serious Christian population and is in a sense become secularized like the United States.
Right.
And he's saying that in the United States it might not necessarily be a good thing that we become more secularized, but in order to incorporate Muslims, in quotes, we need Muslims to be secularized.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of issues along those lines. One of the things that people need to understand is that there's actually a measurable continuum of Islamification of a country, or Islamization, however you want to say it. It's based on percentages of the population. At a very low percentage of the population, people basically don't notice Muslims. And I want to read again from the book, from Professor Srdja Trifkovic's book, where he discusses this. And it's in a section called Intolerance Codified. The House of Islam is in a state of permanent war with the lands that surround it. It can be interrupted by temporary truces, but peace will only come with the completion of global conquest. The progression was from Dar al-Sul, when the Muslims are a minority community and need to adopt temporarily a peaceful attitude in order to deceive their neighbors. The next phase, based on percentage, Billy, is Dar al-Harb, when the territory of the infidel becomes a war zone by definition. This happens as soon as the Muslim side feels strong enough to dispense with pretense. The last stage is called Dar al-Islam, the final objective, where Muslims dominate and infidels are at best tolerated and at worst expelled or massacred. This applies even to the peoples of the book. Well, that's us, Christians and Jews. And Professor Trifkovic goes on to say, in Europe today, the early signs of the final stage amounting to a low-intensity civil war are visible in ethnic disturbances in English and French cities when young English-born Pakistanis or French-born North Africans venture out from their no-go areas. You've heard of this.
Yeah, Dan, footnote, that book was written 10 years ago.
Exactly. That's, as I said, this book was written shortly after the World Trade Center massacre, and it's very prophetic. I mean, this is exactly what's happening. You know, we all know that in most of the major cities in Paris or in France, there are areas where the police just do not go. And it's understood. They won't go. And if you're a Frenchman who's unfortunate enough to have owned a liquor store, a wine shop, or a charcuterie is a butcher shop that specializes in pork. After a while, you get a knock on the door. We want you to shut your shop. We want you to close down.
By what, the Muslim unions or something?
Yeah, exactly, by the followers of the religion of peace. And if you don't shut down, you get firebombed. You get a Molotov cocktail through the front window. This has been going on in Europe for years now. Professor Trifkovic is pretty pessimistic. He says Europe is done. It's history.
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned that, and then we'll get into some of the just... in general terms, some of the percentages and how things break down in terms of the way the countries start developing. But I was up in Boston, and I spoke to somebody who was originally French, and he just came back from France, specifically Paris. And I was asking him how the demographics are there, and the context was Islam. And he said virtually word for word what Dan just said, that Paris is done. And I believe France in general is about, at this point, I think in 2002 when this book was written, it was approximately 8% Muslim. It's about 10% now. And Paris, I believe, is higher than 10%. And he said that the city it's basically, they've conceded that it's going to be taken over by Muslim culture and Muslim theology. And there's almost, when the demographics start moving that direction, and we can get into some of the ideas of birth rates and things like that, there's almost no way to reverse it at this point.
Exactly. It's demographic conquest. As you probably know, a couple of European leaders, Angela Merkel, and I know a couple of others, have come out within the last year and said multiculturalism has failed. I mean, come on, how long did it take you to figure that out? They are not going to assimilate. They're going to absorb the host country. I mean, it's the best description is like a virus.
Well, even if it's somewhat analogous to the situation in Israel, that there are, many people don't realize that there are Arabs / Muslims in Israel, and they compose a large percentage of the population.
Oh, a large majority of the population.
Well, in Israel, it's not a majority, but it's a significant plurality. Well, I shouldn't say it's a plurality, but it's significant. I think it's about maybe 25% or so. And obviously, and the birth rates among the Jews are, the birth rate is much lower than among the Arabs / Muslims. And they understand that this is obviously going to lead to some serious problems with their democracy in a sense.
Well, exactly. It's, the demographic bomb, that's the best way to describe it, is what is going to kill Europe and possibly the United States. Pat Buchanan's written about this. He said that the West essentially died in its series of wars in the late 1800s, early 20th century, World War I, World War II. In fact, Professor Trifkovic describes it as autogenocide.
You know, in what sense did the West die?
Autogenocide. Well,
just that so many people were killed in war?
Sure. And in World War One, I mean, the contempt that the ruling classes had for the people that they ruled, they just sent them into the slaughterhouse for the most ridiculous of reasons. The trench warfare in World War One, the meat grinder that...
So Dan, not to get too far into this, but and irrespective of anybody's political or philosophical position on abortion, the fact is approximately one-third of conceptions in the United States, that is, end in abortion. And well, approximately 50 million people who would have been born or not were not born since Roe v. Wade, and you start multiplying that out by the amount of people that they would have given birth to, and it's much. I would say that it's probably much more significant than war. I mean, how many Americans died in World War II?
Well, exactly. Well, only 500,000.
Okay, so 500,000 as opposed to 50 million.
Yeah, exactly.
So now, I mean, there's
back it up a little bit. What I was trying to do with the World War I and World War II is show where it came from. What happened, World War One was just a horrible war. Men were thrown into the meat grinder in Flanders Fields and other places. The Somme, the Battle of the Somme. The British lost 20,000 men in one day. Just think about that. Think of the trauma our country experiences now when we've lost 4,000 or 5,000 people in Iraq, 57,000 in Vietnam, 20,000 in one day. So what happened to the European powers engaged in World War One is they essentially lost a generation. And then it continued again in World War Two. Another huge hole was blown through the population. So what they had to do...
And also the people who were killed tended to be the young people who were going to have more people.
Sure, sure. The people of parenting age. So what happened was the societies in Europe at the end of World War II had a deficit in the population. You know, for a lot of reasons, that's a problem. Most of all, because they couldn't support the welfare state. The welfare state is based upon taxation, and if you had no new citizens coming in...
So the ratio got way off between workers and recipients.
Exactly. I mean, we know all the problems with socialism anyway, but this is how it played itself out. So what they did... They brought in guest workers. That's where the Muslim infiltration of Europe began. Guest workers after World War II to fill the factories, sweep the streets. And as liberals, they all thought, well, I mean, these people will see the superiority of Western culture and like nice people everywhere, they'll just kind of blend in and they'll learn German, they'll learn French, they'll obey the laws. Well, that didn't happen. They do not want to assimilate.
It doesn't happen by design.
Doesn't happen. Well, it's intentional because that's part of their worldview. I mean, a Muslim knows that they should not apostasy. Is abandoning the Muslim religion. Apostasy is abandoning any religion. In Islam, it's punishable by death. So that's a pretty good incentive not to blend in, not to melt in the melting pot.
Or not even to look like you blend in.
Exactly. So they don't even bother. So this has been going on for 30, 40 years in Islamic countries. So people like Professor Trifkovic now call Europe Eurabia. Eurabia.
So it's the play on Eurasia.
Yeah, exactly. It's
Dan, one thing you just touched on that brought to mind without getting too far afield on this. We're talking about the influx of immigrants. Now, for Americans, people in the United States, to get a more clear understanding of the problem of immigration, specifically by practicing Muslims, if we look at it in terms of the problem in the United States with illegal immigrants, we see the incredible... Without, like I said, we don't want to get into all that whole issue. That's another show. But when we look at that and see it as somewhat analogous to what's going on in Europe now with Muslims, analogize it to illegal aliens in the United States, anywhere from 20 to 40 million.
Well,
the
exactly.
The effect it has on society is enormous. And we have to also keep in mind that it's not like they're, generally speaking, the illegal aliens in the United States are here for their own reasons. They're not philosophical reasons, and they're not a cohesive group like the Muslims are in Europe. Yet the effect is enormous.
Exactly. There's a huge demographic hole in our population from the 50 million aborted human beings in this country. So nature...
But draw some analogies between the...
Well, here's the analogy. Yeah. Nature abhors a vacuum. We need people. That's why the illegal immigrants are here, among other reasons. That's why it's so easy for the Hispanic immigrants to come to this country. Now, between the two
because
types...
Because in a sense, they're needed for this. Somebody's needed somebody, to fill the vacuum.
Somebody's got to cut the lawn. That's the deal. There's a whole lot of other issues with that that are not the topic of this show, but that's essentially what happened. And let me tell you, between the two groups of immigrants, I mean, which would you prefer? The ones that eventually will blend in or the ones that want to chop our heads off?
Right.
If we don't accommodate them. I mean, it's bad. And
so we would be making a big mistake by thinking that Islam, because I think it's the lazy man's way to look at religion, to think that they're all analogous, because they don't want to open up the books. They don't want to learn the history. It's easy to say, well, you got the Muslims who some of whom are terrorists, and then you have the Crusades, so they cancel each other out, and then you go down the list.
Right.
Then you have the Christians who don't follow the Bible, and you have the Muslims who don't follow the Quran, so they kind of cancel each other out, and you just go down the list. And it's when you're lazy and you don't understand this stuff, it's all basically the same. So, and also I think we have to address to some extent the predisposition in our culture today against Western civilization and against Christian culture. And we've kind of invited another religion, it's kind of ironic, but we've invited another religion to become part of it because they see us as the enemy as well. Us meaning Western society and Christianity.
Well, exactly. They're going to come into this country and impose Islam on us. That's what's going to happen. I made a quote before, and I want to back it up from Professor Trifkovic's book. And this is directly quoting, on the eve of the First Crusade, the prominent Islamic scholar Abu Ala al-Mawardi prepared the formal blueprint for the Islamic government based on the Quran, the tradition and the practice of the previous four centuries of conquest. Let me summarize. The people of the covenant, Jews or Christians, do not believe in Muhammad and Islam. Thus, their blood and the Muslims' blood cannot be equal. I was trying to find that quote before. That's the essence of why I say Islam is incompatible with the American Constitution. It's just, as a structural part of it, you have two classes of society. We don't tolerate that in this country. That's why America was formed. It was for freedom for all individuals. And Islam is incompatible with that. It's a terrible thing, but that's what they're preaching. Now, we've been saying that there's been a lot of atrocities. That's the best word for it. And we're going to go down a list on that. And we have a caller, Jane from Pennsylvania. Let's see what Jane has to say. Hello, Jane from Pennsylvania.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
All right. I called in because I have to say that I differ with you on your views regarding which would I rather have, illegals or the Muslims, the Islamists. If you look into illegals, they're heavily entrenched in Aslan, and that's heavily influenced by the Islamic movement. Also, would you want 20 to 40 million people that are going to more than likely vote Democrat and vote for open borders and thereby change our culture forever? So you are, it's two evils, clearly two evils, and I would not, they are both destructive forces, ultimately. Right now. We don't need them. We have plenty of unemployed people, 20 million unemployed in this country, where a man who owes money on a mortgage would gladly mow a lawn if he has to put food on the table or to help pay his bills. So therefore, I just want to call and say that I disagree with what you said.
Well, I can understand that. I mean, that's just that's a personal preference of mine. I prefer that our country maintains its own borders and allowed people to come in through the legal process. I mean, you're right about that. But
we weren't
because they are parasitic.
If I had, they may be parasitic, but
They're not looking to chop your head off.
Exactly.
Not true. If you look up the groups Mecha and look into La Raza, look into Mecha, look into these various other groups, and you'll find out, yes, they do say...
Well, let me describe a difference there.
Like Europeans. And they do say that they want to destroy, they want to take back portion of the United States.
I'm familiar.
They are as evil and as destructive.
I am familiar with Mecha because I lived in Los Angeles for,
all right, thank you.
For 24
bye-bye.
Years. You're welcome. The caller had a good point there. Mecha is a group in the Southwest that wants to return California, New Mexico, Arizona, and Texas to Mexico, but they don't want it to be part of Mexico. They want it to be a new country called Aztlan. So that's a crazy bunch, but most Hispanic immigrants to this country do not adhere to that. That's just not true. Whereas with Islam, by doctrine, you have to adhere to jihad. There's a big difference.
We weren't trying to give the impression that we think illegal immigration's fine and Islam is terrible. That wasn't the point. The point, the analogy was on one point, which is the effect of a group on a culture.
Well, let's talk about that. The test of a religion is the effect on its culture. Modern civilization is a Christian invention. There's a book that everyone should read. It's called Human Accomplishment, written by Charles Murray, and it's a statistical analysis of human accomplishment from the arts and sciences, politics, technology, everything. And going into the book, when I read it, I thought, well, you know, I would say that the West, the Christian West, has been responsible for more than half of the civilizational accomplishments in the world. It's actually about 95%, okay? Civilization is a Christian European invention. And any country that has adopted Christianity has done very well. And I could go into that in a lot of other instances.
What do you do with countries historically like China?
China's becoming a Christian country.
Well, I mean, but historically. Yeah. It's only becoming a Christian country most recently.
Let me give you an analogy about Christianity and non-Christianity. Korea and Vietnam both had internal civil wars in the last century. These countries are about the same size, same type of country, predominantly agricultural. Split in half, communist north, non-communist south. We know what happened in Vietnam. The communists took over. We know what happened in Korea. The southern part of the country stayed free market, democratic, supported by the United States. And South Korea is becoming a Christian country. It's over 50%. South Korea today is the largest shipbuilding industry in the world. They produce electronics. The lucky group, LG, is about to surpass HP as the largest electronics manufacturer in the world, okay? South Vietnam, they're still trying to come back to their production of rice from before the Vietnam War.
I wouldn't say that the quote, test of a religion is necessarily how they function in the material world.
I would say it's not the test, but it's an important indication. What does a religion do for a society? So you have the European West that essentially developed civilization.
So what's the attraction? What's the attraction to Islam? I mean, I know where you're going with this. That the countries that are predominantly Islamic have not contributed much, continue to not contribute much, and are essentially a wreck. And if it weren't for the oil, even the countries, the Muslim-dominated countries, if it weren't for the oil, would be in the same position as the others.
There's a fact here in Professor Trifkovic's book. All of the Muslim countries in the world do not produce annually as much as the country of Finland. Think about that.
Right, minus the oil.
5 million
Finns.
People in 5 million Finns and 50 times as many residents of these Islamic states, and they still cannot produce as much as the Finns do. I mean, you have it right there. So what effect does a religion have on a society? Just take a look. Open your eyes. There's the answer. Now, we're talking about I'm promoting Christianity here. Well, let's talk about what Islam has done where it has wreaked havoc in places like India. And I want to talk about a special case of the city of Smyrna at some point. But, you know, Islam has gone into a lot of countries and promoted jihad. It's been very effective, and it's been very deadly to a lot of places in India. The historian, I'm trying to remember his name, one historian, I think Toynbee perhaps, said that the atrocities that were committed in India just outshine anything in history. I mean, it's just staggering. But let me talk about...
By Muslims against native Indians.
Against infidels.
Okay.
Yeah.
Indian infidels.
Yeah, exactly. As it said, if you're not a Muslim, you're dirt, and you need to be killed or forced to convert. The city of Smyrna in Turkey was... It's in the western shore of Turkey. It was, for years, a Greek Orthodox Christian country, populated by Greeks and Armenians. And after World War I, the Turks were allowed to take over all of the parts of their country that were owned by Greeks, that were populated by Greeks. And they continued the genocide that they had committed against the Armenians in 1915. Where millions of Armenians were killed. In the city of Smyrna, 300,000 people in that area and in the surroundings were either killed or removed into the interior of Turkey, and no one knows what happened to them, but approximately 190,000 people were killed. In the month of September 1922, the Turkish army came in, looted the shops, began killing and torturing the residents of the city, hacking them to death. They came in with trucks and cans of gasoline, set fire to the city, such that the entire population was forced into the waterfront area where gasoline was poured onto them. They were hacked to death. About 190,000 people were killed. This occurred while warships of the victorious powers, England, France, the United States, looked on. They watched this. They were told by the State Department, in the case of the United States, not to interfere with Turkey. They thought it was their problem, it's not our problem. And that story has been obscured ever since. You know, it's on the scale of the rape of Nanking, which we're just hearing about. But this was an atrocity committed within the lifetime of people who are still alive in 1922. And I don't need to tell you about what's going on in sub-Saharan Africa. So this is jihad. This is what it is. We've allowed it to come into our country. We're going to pay dearly for it.
Dan, it seems like more than it seems like we're beyond allowing it at this point. It's like we're inviting it. I mean, a few days is going to be the 10th anniversary of September 11th, the attack on the World Trade Centers and the Pentagon and the plane crash in Pennsylvania. And it seems like we're further back than we were 10 years ago. And Dan and I have recently spoken to people who were at Ground Zero and were privy to the inside information. And there's no question that we've been dabbling in this for years already and that we know the threat. The people who we pay to know the threats do know the threat. Yet it seems like we're just going out of our way to pretend that nothing's wrong here and that the Islamic threat is really not.
Well, exactly. Well, Billy, let me read again from Professor Trifkovic's book. The Muslim population within North America and the rest of the West is not like any other, for it is the only immigrant group that harbors a substantial segment of individuals who share the key objectives with the terrorists, even if they do not all approve of their methods. It would be idle even for ardent Islamic apologists to pretend that many Muslim immigrants do not despise the West in general and the United States in particular, its institutions and all it stands for. To them, their host country is a mine to be stripped, used and converted or destroyed. This was not what other newcomers to America had in mind as they flocked here to enjoy the unique opportunities of freedom. It was not what African Americans fought for as they justly demanded their rights under the Constitution during the Civil Rights Movement. As is evident in the actions and words of many American Muslims, a sizable minority of them wishes to transform their host country into a Muslim country by whatever means, violent or otherwise, justified by the supposed sanctity of the goal and a corresponding Quranic injunction. I mean, that's basically what he's saying. It is a minority that is using terror at this point, but to be a true Muslim, the rest must follow.
Dan, if you can, just if we could just discuss a little bit of the correlation between the political, let's call it liberalism, which it's not historically liberal, but what we commonly call liberalism, and where Islam fits in the United States.
Well, exactly. And in fact, the chapter in Professor Trifkovic's book is called Unholy Alliance, Unholy Alliance, Islam and Liberalism. Basically, it's a record of appeasement. I didn't talk too much about Smyrna, but Smyrna was a pretty particularly egregious case. The people who were looking on as this occurred and refused to interfere were actually people that we know of in mid-history of the 20th century. Alan Dulles was once the head of the CIA. The people who basically took control of our culture after World War I on a governmental and business level were the same people who formed the Council on Foreign Relations. And the needs of American businesses dominated that group and still do today. Even when those needs are opposed to the supposed principles that we adhere to in the Constitution. So those are the people that looked on and permitted Smyrna to occur in visible sight of American warships who refused to help. This is what's going on today. Clinton sent people over to bomb the Kosovarians in the Middle East. We're taking out dictators who we pretend not to like, but they're being replaced with people from Al-Qaeda. So it's a very bad situation. It's, you know, and we've been fighting this scourge since the foundation of this country. You know, in the Marine Corps hymn, it talks about the shores of Tripoli. Those are the pirates that were interdicting American shipping in the Mediterranean in the 1800s, early 1800s. And Thomas Jefferson wanted to fight them. John Adams wanted to pay them off and accommodate them. Jefferson was right at the time. We fought them, and we beat them back. But the attitude of Adams is now preeminent in this country. We want to accommodate them. And it's deadly. It's a terrible thing. And I think, Billy, you pointed out from your reading of the book that people aren't going to forget this. People aren't going to remember the things they should remember. You know, Hitler, at one point, he's talking to his command staff. They're about to instigate the final solution. And some of the generals are saying, well, what's that going to do to us in the eyes of history? And he says, look, history didn't remember Smyrna, so we don't have to worry about what we're going to do. And, you know, to close it out, that's one of the issues we have to think about.
Right. Well, it's something we obviously have to pay attention to. We have to continue this discussion, and we're going to try next week to get it together here and have Professor Srdja Trifkovic on, and he's going to go into a lot more detail, a lot of firsthand information, and we'll see you next week. Billy and Dan out.
Bye-bye.